In this presentation, we will stress the extreme conditions which affect the properties and behavior of the fuel during irradiation. So far, we have discussed the front end of the nuclear fuel cycle, and here we will focus on the next step, which is the irradiation in a reactor, and discuss the consequences on the fuel behavior. The fuel is exposed to very high levels of energetic radiation. It has a high temperature as a result of the heat that is produced in the fission process. It has a changing chemical composition because of the fission product formed, and its cladding is exposed to high temperature water. We will look in this video how this affects the integrity and life of the fuel. The fission process creates two fission products and releases at the same time about 200 mega electron volt energy. Most of the energy is transferred as a kinetic energy to the fission products, which does have the capacity to knock on atoms from the crystal lattice of CO2, creating vacant position and displacing atoms to non-regular interstitial positions. A heavy fission product, such as barium-144, creates about 60,000 defects. A light one, like krypton-89, about 40,000. Many of these defects heal again quickly because of the temperature of the fuel, but some remain and even form clusters or extended defects. In this molecular dynamic simulation, the recall item is the larger represented gray sphere and displaces the uranium in orange and oxygen in blue from their regular lattice positions. While most of the defects are quasi-instantaneously healed, some lattice defects are left at the end of the cascade. As already discussed in a previous presentation, a wide range of fission products is formed and they double the number of original uranium atoms fissioned. These fission products are foreign and most of them do not fit in the crystal lattice of CO2 and form secondary phases such as oxide and metallic precipitates and gases that collect in pores and voids. These secondary phases can be observed by electron microscopy analysis. The gas bubbles with noble gases xenon and krypton, and spherical metallic precipitate containing noble metals. These new phases also contribute to the expansion of the fuel pellets. The temperature in the pellet is depending on two parameters, the amount of heat produced, the linear heat rate, and thermal conductivity of the fuel materials, as this simplified formula shows. As a result of the relatively poor thermal conductivity of UO2, the temperature gradient is steep, about 800 degrees Celsius between the center and the rim of the pellet. Since the gap between the pellet and the cladding is filled with helium, which also poorly conducts the heat, there is an additional temperature step close to the cladding. Because of this temperature gradient, the pellet has a different thermal expansion across the radius, and as a result of the stress, it starts to deform and fracture. As a result of the deformation, the top and bottom edges move outward and can eventually touch the cladding, leading to local stress. To avoid this, the pellet generally have a dish and a chamfer. This can be very nicely seen in this picture of irradiated fuel of low and high burnup, the low burnup fuel still having an open dish, whereas it is closed in the high burnup fuel. As a result of the expansion of the pellet and the inward creep of the zirconium alloy cladding under the influence of radiation, the gap between the pellet and the cladding closes, and with increasing expansion of the fuel pellet with burnup, the pellets start to exert a mechanical stress on the cladding. This can be a possible cause for cladding failure, and this is a possible life-limiting factor for fuel pins. Another limiting factor is the corrosion and degradation of the cladding from the water side. This high-temperature pressurized water is corrosive towards the zirconium alloy, and a zirconium oxide layer is formed. In a chemical reaction, the metal binds the oxygen from the water and sets free hydrogen, which diffuses into the metal and forms zirconium hydride, which can be seen as worm-like precipitate in the photograph. The oxide layer reduces the thickness of the cladding and the hydride affects the mechanical strength of the cladding. The diffusion of oxygen through the zirconium oxide layer to the metal oxide interface is the rate determining step for the oxidation, and this is an Arrhenius type process. Thus, the reaction slows down asymptotically. However, the zirconium oxide layer is brittle and easily fractures or breaks off, a result of which the reaction speed increases again. So the lifetime of the fuel elements is limited to about 4 years, after which the composition of the fuel has changed significantly from pure UO2 to about a material with about 6 to 8% newly formed elements, fission products, and activation products.